boss is understanding. There's a pasture at the end of each road.
Wagon wheel,
rolling, rolling,
wagon wheels. Keep on a turning,
turning,
wagon wheels.
Sing your song, wagon wheels, carry me home.
Wagon wheels, carry me home.
Wagon wheels, carry me.
I got to tell you this. Jimmy Van, Mosey's son-in-law, told us last night that he said, Mosey, you wrote Feeling Fine, Still Feeling Fine. You need to write Finally Feeling Great. And he began working. I don't know if we got a, girls, we got to look in the, no? Yeah. Somebody needs to write it.
Well, no, he's working on it right now.
He's working on it now. You know what? Why don't one of the girls come up? Brenda, yeah, come on up here. This would be a good time. You just take your time and say all that you want to say about your papa. Yeah, this would be great. Come on.
I'm loving the music.
Thank you.
I'm sure today you're going to hear a lot of stories about Dad's professional life. Barbara and I have chosen to share with you some things about his personal life. And if you were close friends with Mosey, you know that he was a gifted storyteller. That's part of what made him a good lyricist. It was from him that we loved to learn some stories. First, we listened to them, then he helped us read them, and ultimately he taught us to write the stories and the poems for ourselves. A few years ago, I wrote a story about him, for him, as part of a devotional series. I'd like to share it with you. When I was a child, I would sit on the bed and I would beg my father as he tucked me into bed, "Tell me about the Navy." And he would sit on the bed and he would talk about how bright the stars looked over the open sea, or about how cold the ocean water was when it would swoosh down into his rack when somebody left the hatch open. Those starry nights and ground swells became the patches in a quilt that I snuggled into, dreaming about Navy life. It was only after I grew up that he shared the real stories of his Navy career. He was wise to wait. These were not the kind of stories that a child could cuddle up with. 1941. As a young man, he leaves his career of professional singing when Pearl Harbor suddenly tilts his world. Following his only brother, he enlists in the Navy. His brother is assigned to the Juno, where brothers were allowed to serve together. So he visits his brother's ship, tours it, and meets the commanding officers. They assure him that the transfer is as good as done. But the next morning, the Juno is gone, and he's transferred to Key West for sonar training. His acute hearing makes him the ideal candidate. He serves on a subchaser for several months, accurately differentiating between our ships and theirs, and precisely estimating speed and direction. He said with a shrug, "It's just a matter of tempo and frequency." And it is. His music teachers would have been very proud. Meanwhile, the Juno goes missing. His world tilts again. A torpedo had struck her in the magazine and the ship had exploded. His only brother, he said, was gone in a cloud of smoke and debris. Recalling his tour of the ship, he realizes that both the sonar room and his brother's station were adjacent to the magazine, and had he been with his brother, neither would have survived. Months later, he's asked to change shifts with another sonar man. During that shift, a depth charge explodes near the sensors, dismantling the eardrums of the substitute. His music teachers would have been relieved. As I learned the truth, I began to see patches of a different quilt, ships that are songs, the unspeakable pain of losing your only brother, and a life spared from deafness by a last-minute decision. I do not pretend to know the ways of God, but for whatever reason, I am still here, he says. Had I been there, where I wanted to be, there would very likely have been know where no one stands alone, and know till the storm passes by. My father was confident that God has orchestrated his days. Some nights, I wrap that quilt around me as I close my eyes. Not the first one, the second one, with the patches of pain and death held together by God's providence and protection. And I sleep the innocent sleep of a child, content that my heavenly Father holds my life in his hand.
Calvin Newton, is here singing the choir, and let me tell you, all of the choir folks here, the homecoming folks are here because they love Mosey, and they would honor Mosey. But Calvin sang in the very very first quartet. Just come here. I want everybody to see you, Calvin. Be careful there. Calvin sang in the very first quartet that Mosey was part of. in Tampa, Florida, right? It was the what, the Deep South, Sunny South?
No, Melody Masters.
Melody Masters, yeah. Good. one out of three is not bad, is it? Oh, okay.
Me and Lee Kitchens and Mosey put it together. Big Chief, Weatherington, and Jake Hess. I was pretty good group. I was 16 years old, and I lived with Mosey. Yeah. He wouldn't let me stay by myself. He said I was too young, and I probably was. But he sort of adopted me for a few years, and I loved Mosey very much. And I loved Lee very much. I drove 2,800 miles last week to see Lee get buried, and I'm not quite right yet, but I'll be there. And I love you, Bill Keith.
Thanks. I want you to meet Calvin. Elvis Presley got a Grammy for this song, so we love it.
Other friends that I have known may pass me by. Other friends may never see the teardrops in my eyes. Other friends may never know the pain I bear, but every tear he wipes away, and every heartache shared.
I will never walk alone. He holds my hand. Oh,
Considering Mosey's military service and his granddaughter's husband, a Navy chaplain, and granddaughter, they're going to come up and perform one of them, something that's so fitting and so beautiful. I know our country has issues, but we still have the freedom to do what we are doing here now and sing about Christ all that we want to, and it's because of men like Mosey. We're willing to go fight for us to have that freedom. So let's honor him that way.
My granddaddy, Thomas Mosey Lister, enlisted in the U.S. Navy on February 16, 1942. He was assigned to Naval Station Key West for training as a sonarman. He served aboard a U.S. Navy subchaser for several months and then was transferred to Fisher's Island Naval Station for advanced training. Following training, he was shipped overseas to an advanced naval base in Nigeria in support of the war effort. Following his assignment in Algeria, where he injured his back, he was assigned to the Naval Hospital in Long Island, New York. He received an honorable discharge on June 28, 1945.
In days past, two bells marked the end of the routine day aboard ship. It was time for a tattoo, and soon taps would sound. Certainly, this is a most appropriate time to honor our departed shipmate. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please bow your heads as we honor the life and the naval service of Sonarman Second Class Thomas Mosey Lister. The toll of the ship's bell reminds us of the reverence that we owe to our departed shipmate. To those who guard the honor of our country upon the sea, in the air, and on foreign soil. Let it be a reminder of the faith that they confide in us to continue the legacy of selfless service that they leave behind. Let us who gather here not forget our obligations and in silence breathe a prayer to Almighty God for our absent shipmates, family, and friends. Will you please stand with me? We dedicate the following moment of reverence to the memory of Sonarman Second Class Thomas Mosey Lister and to all of our shipmates who have gone before us. Thank you. You may be seated.
There's a light that shines in darkness. There's a light that won't grow dim. Help. Father, hold on, hold on to Him. Hold on until the
till the day my castle's grand. swept away. In each life, storms will gather, rains descend and wild winds blow. Wise the man who in God is anchored fast. Are you then like that wise man? Are you anchored? Do you know? Storms of life are past. Castles built upon the sand, though they seem to be so grand, will surely melt away, for in life's raging storm they cannot stand. In the rock of the ages, all my hopes are built today, and in the rock they will never
put you on the spot now. Come on up. I told your sister you'd take your time.
Daddy was a public figure, but to me and my sister, he was so much more. He was our father who left us a legacy of faith and values. And here's a glimpse into that part of his life. He gave us a love of books long before we could even read. As we grew older, many of his afternoons were spent walking us to the neighborhood library, patiently waiting with us through the vast sea of choices and heartily endorsing the fine art of reading. This pleasure, along with piano practice, was probably the only thing that could be pressed into service to trump the doing of chores. I can't even walk the dog now in the cool of the day without visiting this memory, and I ache to go back there even now. Through our high school days, homework was priority, again, slightly ahead of chores. And we knew that we had carte blanche to walk into his inner sanctum and ask for help. His reply was never, "Oh, go look it up," but it was always, "Let's look it up." We'd break out the old world books or the Britannica and peruse until the question was completely answered. Today, I go to Google, but it's as if I can still hear his voice saying, "Do your research, honey. Stand on solid ground." He taught us biblical values. I remember distinctly an incident involving a birdhouse. He had hammered it together for us. We were maybe 10 years old, and invited us to paint it. Each of us was handed a brush and a small container of paint. Now, Dad was a good teacher, and he spent some time showing us exactly how to dip the brush into the paint and how to spread it evenly using the proper grip and proper wrist motion. He was actually very good at this. Anyhow, we each had our side to paint, I remember painting diligently on my side, and then I took a break to inspect Brenda's. I saw runs and drips. Not pretty. I even made several snarky comments, and Dad walked over to inspect mine. He quoted Jesus' admonition to remove the beam from your own eye before you start addressing the one in your sister's. To my shame, the evidence was clear. Those drips and runs, they'd come over to my side too. If you catch me being snarky, remind me, okay? Our daddy had a kind and gentle spirit that could diffuse tension and put teenage angst in its proper place. He had a humor that could ease the torture of early mornings instead of an alarm. We had an intentionally abrasive tenor rendition of Wabash Cannonball. I wish you could have heard it. Complete with bone-shaking volume on an old Martin guitar. And through life's storms, his faith held strong. Even as he breathed his last, I believe that we saw in his eyes the wide-eyed wonder at the unseen heavenly attendants who were prepared to usher him home. So I leave you with this reflection of his journey here and his journey into eternity. He had tasted life's troubles, its pain, and its glory, yet he'd seen no glory like this at the last. The song of the angels, heaven's morning light resplendent, earth's boundaries lost in the past. For triumph would come when the battle was done, when midnight gives way to the dawn, then to rise, bursting forth to life evermore, incorruptible, vibrant, and strong. We don't grieve as those who have no hope. We'll see you, Daddy, on the other side.
Like a king, I may live in a palace so tall, with great riches to call my own. But I don't know a thing in this whole. So worth being alone.
Hold my hand all the way, every hour, every day, from here.
is not a Southern Gospel program going on this weekend that is not going to be singing The Unclouded Day, which you did not write, I'll Fly Away, or this great classic that just lives on.
I appreciated what you had to say. It's hard for the rest of us to remember sometimes that Mosey Lister is more than an icon and a writer of these wonderful songs. He's a human being with a family, and we really do love you for sharing him with us, truly, truly. I won't take but a few moments, I promise. I want you to know that I never knew anybody like him, never knew anybody like him, and realized this week when I had this opportunity that the first person ever to minister to me, I was in a completely unchurched family, the first person ever to minister to me was Elvis. Isn't that amazing? In his music, I knew he had blue suede shoes, but thanks to Mosey, I knew that he never had to walk alone in them. Amen? And that was important for me because I had never really heard much about this God except that he was probably mad. He's probably upset because, well, I had done a few things, you know, this and that. On Sunday mornings, I would get up and watch the Gospel Singing Jubilee in Tampa, Florida. I don't know if it was all over the country, but in Tampa, Florida, we got up and watched the Gospel Singing Jubilee because of the music. It was just the music. We had no intention of getting dressed and going to church in the least, but we would listen to the Rebels and we would listen to Vestal Goodman, and we just couldn't help ourselves. You know, it was just wonderful music, and it brought us together with people who had nothing in common with us except the love of music. And from that context, I was prepared a little bit for the idea of this Savior that might actually love me later when I was able to trust him as my Savior personally. At the age of 16 years old, standing in a youth choir, didn't know any of the songs, couldn't quote the Lord's Prayer, just ignorant. We were given the page number, and as I turned to that, and I loved the music, and I always had the ability to harmonize. I didn't know where that came from, but I could, you know, so I enjoyed that. And listening to those lyrics, in the dark of the midnight, have I oft hid my face, while the storm howled above me, and there was no hiding place. And as a 16-year-old boy, you might think there's not enough storm to warrant that. But later when I met Mosey, I found out that he didn't feel that way. A 16-year-old's problems are his problems, amen? And he was the youngest person I knew in that context. He always believed that a young person had their problems and they ought to be encouraged too. I was so thrilled to get to meet him in person. When I was in my late 20s, I worked for a company that did alarm systems, and as I got my morning orders that day, there was a name there, Mosey Lister, and I thought, it can't be. Old Carrollwood, Mosey Lister. Can't possibly be, because, well, probably he lives in Nashville or Hollywood or somewhere, New York, I don't know. And as I got to the house and knocked on the door, the lovely lady answered and let me in, and I trepidatiously asked, could this possibly be the Mosey Lister, you know, that wrote all those songs? And she said, yes, honey, come on in. And she takes me straight to the piano, and I got to sit on the piano with Mosey Lister while he was composing. By the way, in the very first picture of him as a baby, doesn't it look like he's trying to work out a chord progression? It really does. I mean, he can't speak, but he knows there's something about that fifth that's not right. And he just, that's the way he was. And when I left that day, I was in trouble because I'd spent an hour and a half with him and had all this other stuff to do, but I had a big box of choir books and printed music and all kind of cool things that he'd given me. He cared about people, and I was just people. Amen? He was just one of those wonderful people. In talking with him, by the way, he sat in my congregation for a while. Speak of intimidating, to have that fellow in the audience when you're speaking, because sermons take all sorts of forms, and he had written better sermons than I ever will, and put music to them and the cadence and everything else that goes with it. And it was wonderful to know him as a person. And in fact, he was my advisor one time when, as I may just put this, sometimes God's wonderful people don't behave quite so wonderfully. And I was among them, absolutely. But he was my advisor, and I his, at a time when he was going through some legal struggles and difficulties that he just didn't know what to do. And so we prayed together and we talked about it. But the point I'm getting at is that he treated me as a human being, an equal. I was someone who had some value and some merit in his eyes. And he always loved the idea of making a difference to the world. That prayer as a boy, Lord, show me a way, use my music to take the gospel to the world, was what he really meant. We're not doing a very good job of that these days, and maybe we need to get back to the way he did it, because there's a terribly dysfunctional relationship between the church and the world. Maybe it's because we're always seeing each other at our worst. We look at the world today and say, your culture is so filthy and vile, it isn't worth saving. But I don't remember Mosey ever saying anything like that. He wanted to, and by the way, he never used the word engage the culture. To our military friends here, to engage means to attack, if you will. We engage the enemy. We don't want to engage the world. We want to contribute to the world. We want to show them the beauty. We're the only ones who have a right at all to be feeling fine. I've got news for you. We've read the end of this book, and it all works out great for those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. The difference is we want to share that with this world. We see them when we say, your culture is not worth saving. They look at us and they say, your righteousness is false. They see the things. They see us at our worst. They see the things that happen in our lives, and they know that we're not what we should be all the time. The problem there is that we have focused on us and our doings instead of Christ and his doings. We have defined ourselves by what we do not do. And Mosey was never like that. He was always a proponent of grace. And I know that he would want me to take just a moment. If you're here today and you loved him just for his music and have never met his Savior, I have some really great news for you. According to Colossians 1, if you feel that there's something wrong between you and God, that you're God's enemy, that verse says that that is in your mind. There is no problem between you and God on his part. He has reconciled you to himself. On the cross of Calvary, he has paid for that sin that you're so worried about, that the accuser keeps mentioning and throwing up in your face. All that is paid for on the cross of Calvary. Now, I have news for you too. I saw a church sign the other day, by the way. As an aside, I think that we should vote right now to cancel all church signs. They should be taken down. Because this one, it was really, you know, lovely, but it said that prayer is God's last hope for America. And I got news for you. If God hasn't come up with a better plan than that, we're in trouble. He wants you to turn off Nashville and start praying, or at least pray on the commercials. Brothers and sisters, that's not it. God's hope for America is Jesus, the same as it always was. And that's the power of Mosey's music. Not just the wonder of his ability musically, but the subject matter is the great Savior and his amazing grace. Amen? I'm almost finished. Just hold on. I get to thinking about what he said to me about some of these things and the spirit that he had of the grace of our God. The grace of our God to reach into this life, an unchurched, uneducated, ignorant idiot, and wrap me in grace. Amen? Just love me until I believed. Those of you who are songwriters, if you want the world to repent, this is the way you do it. You write more music about grace because it is the grace of our God that leads us to repentance. He is not looking for a way not to save us. If he had wanted that, he would have stayed home. Amen? He would have just stayed home. But he didn't. He came and robed himself in flesh. And he died on a cross. He became like us and died on a cross for us. He owed no death. And brothers and sisters, he paid for yours in so doing. Amen. Almost finished. Never one time did I hear him say, these young people today. In fact, the most amazing thing he ever said to me, we were talking about different music styles, and someone had made a comment about Christian rock and how it was just wrong, just Christian rock. And Mosey spoke up and said, why should the devil get all the good music styles? And so I had to take a lisinopril or something, you know, because my blood pressure jumped. And I thought, you know, he's right. This guy who is way older than me is way younger than me. He had an attitude that Jesus could use just about anything, anybody, if they would allow him to be used, allow themselves to be used. And so why should the devil get all those things? We should never start sentences with these young people today. I find myself worrying sometimes that Billy Graham's too old to have revivals and too old to have crusades. What's God going to do now that Billy is so old? Well, he's going to raise up his son. He's going to raise up his grandson. Cerulean or whatever his name is. I cannot pronounce it, but I know I love the guy because he teaches grace. He teaches the most amazing thing. And Christians, this is what I want to leave you with today. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 6. As you have therefore received the Lord Jesus, so walk you in him. Did you know I wasted way too much of my life, and Mosey was quick to point this out, way too much of my life thinking that God's upset and I'm not getting my groove on, I got to get started. But the way I got saved, we'll all preach Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, it is by grace through faith that you're saved, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So in the same way that you received the Lord Jesus, so walk ye in him. That means live every day by that same faith, that you are going to make mistakes, but that your Father has already taken care of that in the cross of Calvary. The focus must not be on what I do, it must be on what Jesus did. Otherwise, we leave the world in their filthy addictions, and we can stand in the self-righteousness of ourselves and look down at them. But that is not the gospel. The gospel is the good news that Jesus Christ loves every man, woman, and child in this world and died for every single one of them. And Mosey wanted that to go out in his music and in everything he did. The pressure is off, brothers and sisters. I want you to know that we're the only ones, again, who have a right to feel fine today. Almost finished. Thank you again to the family. Mosey was one of those people that added to the beauty of things. And that is irresistible. When you can show the world Jesus Christ, and they have a moment to look into sinless eyes and see absolutely no condemnation, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, that is irresistible. And that's what we should be doing today as the church. That is what he tried to do. Other words here. Mosey's the first one that told me too. He was really caustic sometimes. He would get a little caustic. And he reminded me as a pastor that the music service is not just filler to get to where I'm going to go. LJ, you believe that? And of course, here all the time, I thought I was the headliner. But what he showed me is that the music and the message and everything else is leading to the real headliner, Jesus Christ. Amen. If everything that we do here today doesn't point to Mosey and right over his shoulder to the Savior that he served, well, we kind of failed in all that we were going to do. There was another song written recently, not too recently, but there's two lines out of it that grabbed me in the context of Mosey's life and his ministry to me. And those words were these: he stood between my heart and Satan's knife with just the armor of a song. And it really is true that music is not the filler. God used it as the main event. He marched the army out with the singers. Amen? And the singers did all these wonderful things. And a lost little boy will listen to Vestal Goodman sing on Sunday morning who doesn't know what the inside of a church looks like. Amen? And so that is a wonderful thing. Let me read these words to you one more time because they've meant so much to me. I will never walk alone. He holds my hand. He will guide each step I take. And if I fall, I know he'll understand. Till the day he tells me why he loves me so, I can feel his hand in mine. That's all I need to know. Brothers and sisters, the focus of that line and that song over and over again is he and him. God bless you. I love you guys so much.
This man was one of the first major influences on our lives as far as a writer is concerned. And I always put you in the same category, and I know you don't mind these categories, of Ira Stanfield, who I think was a great writer, Stuart Hamlin was a great writer, And Mosey was a very special. This was all before the 60s, before Dottie and a lot of other writers came along. But this man blazed the way. Started writing convention tunes back, what, in the 40s, Mosey?
In the, about 1948, 40, yeah. 47, yeah. 46, 41, 30. Yeah. Somewhere, but I don't remember. See, when you're as old as I am, you can say, I forget.
Okay. And he is no relation to Hobie Lister, but in the early days, he started writing all of those fun tunes and arrangements for the Statesman. All that real tight four-part harmony. You wrote that stuff. There's going to be a great... He wrote all that stuff. And all that fun stuff. There's a happy rhythm, keys are rocking, and then the roll and I could feel a boo-boo when to sing the song. He was the first rapper gone, ever. I mean...
Yeah, my granddaughter said I invented rock and roll because I said rockin' and rolling.
You said rockin'
before it, yeah, before it came.
Yeah,
it was my idea, but nobody knows about it.
And also, and also, Mosey and I have a lot in common. We sometimes stammer when we.
You're kidding.
When we talk, when we get on the phone, a telephone conversation.
It's a mess. It can be a mess.
Yeah.
But I'm relaxed right now, aren't you? How do you feel?
Yeah, I'm relaxed. Yeah.
Okay.
But. A lot of great songs Mosey's written. How long has it been? Where no man stands alone, till the storm passes by. This is probably one of his greatest. And the first person I ever heard sing this was Jay Cass. But I heard the Booth Brothers arrangement the other day. You got to hear this arrangement of Mosey's "Then I Met the Master." Give him a good one.
Like a babe when it cries for its mother, like a child I was helpless, alone. Then I met the Master. Blind man who walks in the darkness, I had longed, I had searched for the light. Then I met the Master. I'm
Mosey.
Number three, turn it up, would you? He's the oldest teenager in America. I thought I was, but he is the oldest. He was the oldest teenager in America. Turn this up, and also turn up the speakers. I asked Gloria before we came. I said, "Honey, do you want to say something?" And today she said, "No, Mosey's lyrics speak for itself." And then she came in the room. And she heard the four-part harmony. And she heard the lyrics, and I saw her. A writer has to write. She was scribbling stuff. And she said, "Yeah, I want to say, you want to do it up there, honey, where you can put your thing down?" You want to do it on that mic or this mic?
I think it was one of Shakespeare's sonnets that said, "You will live in these words, and these words give life to thee." From this earth, this seems to be the end of this wonderful man. But his songs are eternal because they're eternal. Mosey Lister was a study in contrasts. He wrote more happy songs than almost any other writer. He gave our feet songs to dance to when we were feeling mighty fine. He seemed to feel the happy rhythms of life itself and how he loved rhythms, intricate, syncopated, grin-making rhythms. Joy was his wish for this service. So we will best have honored him by being joyful. Mosey also walked the path of loneliness and doubt. He gave us chords and words to express the times of fog, when nothing seemed clear and happy rhythms are but a dim memory. He was a master of affirming a deep faith in the choice to trust what we have come to know from our history with God. In so many of his songs, he reminded us to trust what we know about his character until the mist subsides, the path begins to reappear, and the joy returns. When we feel the pain of loneliness, he encouraged us to stay put in the place where no one stands alone. He helped us recognize the tricks of the enemy of our souls that uses as his battle tactic the times of discouragement to whisper his toxic notion. There's no need to try. There's no end of sorrow. There's no hope by and by. Yet even if this whole human experience were all a storm of sorts, a strong song comes at just the right time to throw us a buoy with the assurance that the storm will indeed pass by and that our souls are dwelling in a land where the tempest never comes. If Mosey left us any message in his 84 years of writing, it is clear that that message would be this. Don't let Satan steal your joy. Hard times will come, but say goodbye to the blues as soon as you can by recalling the goodness of the Lord who will never let go of your hand. Today he is for sure feeling mighty fine. And probably taking the solo on the last verse of this one. Now don't you weep for me when I'm gone, for I won't have to leave here alone. And when I hear that last trumpet sound, my feet won't stay on the ground. I'm gonna rise with a shout, gonna fly, gonna rise with my Lord to the sky. Heaven is here, and I can't stay near. Goodbye, world, goodbye.
Still.
Many times Satan tells me there is no need to try, for there's no end of sorrow, there's no hope. By and by, but I know thou art with me. And tomorrow I'll rise where the storm never darkens the skies. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever.
Instructions about his funeral. And about 5 or 6, 7 years ago, he said, I hope this is not going to happen for a long, long time. He wrote a bunch of O's in it. But when it does, I want it to be joyful, uplifting, and all these good things. And I want you to close with this song. And he and I really belong to a very elite fraternity of people who, when you get excited or you get tired and you run out of energy, you stammer.
And Martha used to laugh when we got on the phone, because the phone conversation sometimes would be pretty long, with me waiting for him to quit stammering and he waiting for me to quit stammering. And this, I guess the reason I love this song, there's something about people who deal with this, and I dealt with it more as a kid. As I got older, I knew how to psych myself up and not do it as badly until I get out of energy and get tired. But this lyric, where are you? And come here. This lyric, I think, is expressing another thing that I think that poetic, artistic people feel from time to time, and it exhibits itself in a lot of different kind of ways. And his was stammering. And the first lyric is what? And
someday the stammering tongue.
Someday the stammering tongue
will falter no more.
Will falter no more.
And a grander, sweeter song.
I will. So we're going to sing this as the closing Mosey tune. I've been overwhelmed. There are no needs for words here today. He said it in his songs, didn't he? For you who didn't know him, wouldn't you like to have known him? What a hope. Listen.
My song.